Ladies and gentlemen, put your mobile phones into silent mode. The show begins right now.
One last time, good evening, Kiev! They say, save the best till last. And I think you're going to be astounded by the stories our next speaker will be able to tell you. A man I could spend hours listening to, retelling old bartenders of yore. Served 38 years with the Savoy Group, 24 years of those at the American Bar, one of the world's best bars, 24 years at a single bar, really showing the dedication and profession. A previous president of the United Kingdom Bartenders Guild, and now a national ambassador for the IBA. So, I don't think I'll say too much more, because I'm sure he can regale you with all his stories. Can I please hear a huge round of applause for the legend that is Peter Durelli! Woo!
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain I've lived.
There you are. Hello, good evening. Thank you for the applause. Nice to be here. Thank you to Barometer to invite me this evening to talk to you, youngsters. You know, I like this light. I can hardly see you. But anyway, you look good. You look good. Well, there you are. So, shall we start? We're talking about something about hospitality here. So, and I'm sure you allow me, the courtesy, shall we say, or the so kind. You look very kind people here. But my brain is not what it used to be. I just sat to the previous presentations, and all these youngsters here, they have amazing memory. They remember everything. I have a little problem there. So if I have any problem, and I got some notes in here in front of me, so I'll step down and I'll do my bit. But there should be an electric chair. Don't you think of my time, electric chair to bring me here? Anyway, I will be down there and check of my notes, because I have a very bad timing. I usually go always over the top, so I have to do 1 hour. So it's a pretty tall order for me. I usually go well over when I start chatting and never ending. But that's the Italian as well, a little bit of Italian on me. Okay, shall we start then, shall we? Okay, let's go for it. If you're ready, of course. Eh? Right, here we go. Who am I? There you are, guys. I've come from a little town called Rome. It happens to be in Italy, but Rome is Rome. There are only a few gladiators there left. And there you are. And I left it to go to United Kingdom. At the young age of 18, that's in 1958. So I remember that London had the war things, it didn't help. So I built London, shall we say. Yeah, fill a few holes, Yeah, there you are. And in 2019, 56 years as a bartender. All right, and practically 61 years, as you can say, you can see that 61 years is in a catering industry. So we talk about all the other parts, all the other departments. I tried everything, and the most of it in the American bar, as you can see. I took an early retirement in 2003. So I'm still enjoy the 16 years of which it seems to be a never-ending holiday. Until, of course, you youngsters here made me work, like today, what to tonight, give me little jobs here and there. And and that's what I do. I go around the world, and they give me, as I say, the judging cocktail, do presentation, and that's to have a little go and have fun, you see? All my life is now fun. Where you are, look, I'm proud to say that I have a cocktail on the man in my name. It's very nice, isn't it? Eh? I reached the top guy. Here you are, by Eric Lawrence, the head bartender, ex-bartender of the Savoy. Well, not bad, isn't it? Cognac, Martini Gran Lusso Vermouth, very nice, pineapple, lemon juice. And I don't know about this garnish gold leaf optional. I think it should be a must, don't you think? I mean, there's this optional bit. And there you are. That's it. That's me. Shall we go? I'm hoping to go finish it before, because I enjoy the questions. I hope I need enough room to give me some questions, you know, have some questions for me, because I enjoy the question more than anything else. Eh? Right, so here we go. I do have to press again? Okay, so shall we do maybe another one? Ah, as it was. Okay, ooh, very good. Sorry. 21st century, yes. You know, I enjoy this one. All right, it's okay. That's nice. You know, I've entered the 20th. I even got more mobile, so okay, my gosh. And I tweet and I blog. And I also Instagram as well, guys. So just in case you wonder. So when I went to the American bar, the first time I approached the American bar, there as he was. You think about it. Look at this. It could be a tiki bar now, isn't it? It could be a fantastic tiki bar. They had also the chairs and the table in bamboo. So it would be an amazing tiki bar. The three people in the middle, they are all the three predecessors, shall we say, the people before me. The one on the left, the one on the three, the left is Victor, Harry Vickers. There are only two Vic in American bar. He's one, Harry Vickers. The middle one is Johnny Johnson. Johnny Johnson is the head bartender during the war. That was something, quite an amazing time to bartending, avoiding the doodle bar, the bombs are there. Quite an interesting quantity. So they definitely, a few times they were shaken by the bang. Interesting. And then on the right of that is my teacher, my mentor, Joe Gilmore. That is one. Now, and this is what it used to be, and if this thing works, and later, oh my goodness, oh wow. How many times I have to press this? Boom. Oh, there you are. This is what is now. Anybody's been to the American Bar Savoy? Yeah. Yes, well, there you are. This is what it is now. The only thing that have changed, really, is about 8 months ago. They changed the chairs and the table. But the rest is the same. The picture is the same. And this guy there, I don't know. I had a few. Oh, let me do something else for you. I never done it before, but because they're such a nice guys, I take my hat off. I don't usually do that, so there you are. Let me get out of here. Can I get up there again? I don't know. Can I? Yes, all right. Okay, so there you are. That's what it used to be. I mean, this is what it is now. It's amazing what the job they're doing. And there you are. Five of the last living head bartenders. Starting from the left, that's me. I think it'll be shiny a little bit more than usual. And Eric Lawrence, she's a pastor, just past head bartender. But the middle there, is 92 years old. 44 years in the American Bar, 67 years with the Savoy Company. And he's an knighted bartender by the Queen. An OBE, he's got a medal from the Queen for the service industries. Amazing, amazing man. I worked with him, of course, needless to say, wonderful. The next to him is Salim Khoury, who came after me. When I left, he became. And now Maxim Schultz is a present bartender, head bartender at the Savoy. Yeah? And let's see what. And our motto, the Savoy and the American Bar motto, was in excellence you strive, which means do your best. You should always do your best. Yes? Right, here we go. Let's see if we are. You are my mentor. In those days, you think about in my times. We're talking about my times now, and we talk about the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and so on, right? So, when I developed the passion, we had done all the outlets in hotels, so when I developed really the passion of bartenders, really, when I entered, it was me. I didn't want to be anything else. I didn't wish to be anywhere else. That's my life, you could say career. But it was my life, nothing to do with career, it was my life. But in those days, there were no where to learn. I mean, there were no schools, no training courses, and there were nowhere to learn. So the only way I could do that, to further my career or learning, is to learn on the job. And the Savoy, in those days like this today, this was the bar, so you can imagine how difficult it was to me to get there. But in life, you need a bit of luck. You can make your luck, but always need a bit of luck. So I chanced it. I went to the American Bar, and I met this guy, Joe Gilman, on a Friday. And I had an interview with him for 20 minutes. The next thing he said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, nothing. I'm available. I can do anything you want." And he looked at me and he said, "Well, Friday morning, 9:30 sharp." I won the jackpot. I said, "My God, did I hear right? And that's where it all started. And I became, obviously, I learned all about bartenders and bar from him, which was an amazing bartender. By the way, the head bartender in those days was the manager, today manager. The head bartender was the manager and the bartender was in charge of entire bar. And in Joe Gilmore left at the start in 54 and left at 75. All the predecessors before him and after him and me as well, after all that, we made the cocktail for special occasions. Always, we've been just followed tradition, it was a tradition. And that's two of the cocktails of him. Look, that's amazing. He was about, marketing guy. He knew about how to do, work it. So moonwalk, for example, here you are. It's grapefruit, Grand Marnier, rose water, and champagne. And that he sent the recipe and a drink to Houston in '69. By the way, it was just to celebrate. We had a fantastic party at the American Bar two and a half months ago. Because we celebrated 50 years of the wonderful cocktail. And the embedded code, there you are. Yes, you can see at the center, center of the astronauts there, amazing, in Houston. And when he came down on Earth, back to Earth, and after the quarantine, that is the cocktail they had. They drank, the first thing they drank was this cocktail. And he sent, Neil Armstrong sent a letter for them. And Uncle Link up as well. I don't know if I had to read it, but anyway, that's Southern Cup for the link up with the Russians and Americans. Southern Cup for Russian vodka and lime juice. And it's on when NASA told the astronauts up there, they reply, "Tell Joe we want it up here." What an amazing marketing exercise, don't you think? And that's even without the media today, the social media. He worked it out wonderfully. So do the same, guys. You know, if you want to be famous, if you want to be, wonderful things in life, be recognized, do the same thing, do something for special occasions. There you are. Now the Savoy is a central position, is the middle of London, right? So I used to be geographically, and it was very much in the middle of everything that went into London. One of them is the newspaper world. So we had a lot of newspaper people coming to very curious media people. So the only thing I had to do is be very careful what I said and what I done, because otherwise it would be the next day newspaper front page. So very dangerous people, newspaper people. The second thing is also in the middle of the city, the business people, the stockbroker, the bankers. Now they were very highly strung, very, very uptight people. And so I had to look after, not really trying to calm them down, look after them and allow to relax. It wasn't easy. But the third thing, it's all full of well-known people, the celebrities. And they are the ones I give it to you, just a few of them. I don't know if you recognize some of them. I did it because, a bit multiply by that by 100, and then you get the message about the Savoy, yes? And they were obviously very important to be recognized, to look after them. But most important is to guard them, because they need their privacy, as well as everybody else. That was a tough order, that one. You can imagine, I don't know, anyone here? Where do we go? Harrison Ford, there you are. This guy, coming to the bar. Think of the ladies in the bar. Harrison Ford, yes. You're right, you're smiling. You would do the same thing, would you? Yeah, you're right. So what do you mind? I had to be a bodyguard. I had to be Mr. Ford. He was a guy, always a dry martini, came to dry martini, reading his paper, the usual table. And I had to be a bodyguard. And I said, please, ladies, sit down, because he's entitled to his own space. And applies to practically every one of them. So it was a tough one. So just give you an insight of what things I had to do. And then there's one. And they were all, without being discourteous, but they are quite unusual people, to be the least. Anyway, so there you are, in previous times. Now, we had very little. Honestly, we had very little in those days. We had very few ingredients. We are and very, very difficult to get, because again, we talk about the war here, after the war. And to think about what we today in comparison what you do today. If anybody asks me for a bourbon, bourbon old fashioned, bourbon and coke, whatever you like, we only had Jack Daniel as a bourbon. And you know very well that Jack Daniel is not a bourbon, it's a sour mash from Tennessee. Yeah? So that's one thing. Think about now today, trendy, the tequila. Tequila, two tequilas. It's Montezuma and Cuervo. I don't know if you know this too yourself, but I promise you this was nothing, as today, nothing in comparison of what is today, tequila. It was quite a rough sort of affair. And the juice, think of the fruit. Orange, lemon, okay, you say, and pineapple. That's the things that we use most. But then, of course, there's banana banshee or something, if you could do something with banana. Apple, yeah, that's it. The first lime I've seen in my life was in 1968, and I didn't know what to do with it. I said, what the hell is that, And it cost £1, 1 shilling, which is a guinea. So 1 pound, 1 shilling today, you could be something like about £3. So it would be what? It would be £3 or three, I think it's 30 for a pound. I think it would be about 100 of your currency, 100, for one lime. So the company wouldn't pay. I had to pay with my money, but then I discovered what to do with it. But in 1968. So you take a lot for granted, guys, but I promise you there was a tough. And juices, lemon juice, orange juice, pineapple juice, and apple juice. That's it. That's what we had. So we had very little. We did a lot with it, I think. Yes? My question is, now you have a lot. What do you do with it? Question mark. It's up to you to decide. Yes? So the cocktails in those days were all practically classic cocktails. As I said, the juice is very, very, very expensive. They were not, and really a couple of twists on a cocktail, on a classic. But so, there were simple drinks in those days. They were quite simple, apart from the one that I create, and as I said, for special occasion. But even then, we were quite simple. It took about three or four ingredients. So we had the time was, you know, the actual life, it was much slower than it's now, much slower. And the cocktail were very simple to make. So we had a lot of time to look after our customers. That was very what we had. It's a luxury, as you said. And as I said, is the only bars, cocktail bars in my time, it was just hotel bars. There were no other bars. There were, in England, there were pubs selling beers, maybe a gin and tonic, or maybe a whiskey with ice, but that's about it. This is not one other place. Right, shall we go ahead and see what we can do? There you are. Where you are? How things have changed. You think about it, how many classic cocktails you have today? In the mid-1800s until the Roaring 20s, this is the first, shall we say, the first golden age, the golden age of bartenders and bars, right? How many cocktails that have been created? And how many actually classic cocktails you know today? Very few, compared with all the things that they've done. Why? Because in my days as well, the only media we had are the people, our customers. They are the one. They are the only one. And they're the one to pass the information, obviously, to travel. Only people with a lot of money used to be able to travel in those days. My first flight was a Super Constellation with four propellers. Before the jet. So, and it was very scary things to travel, but very expensive to travel. So the only people who could afford it is the people who had lots of money, who were, you know, all the money. So, and there were the media, the you know, the newspaper, the, you know, the prime ministers, the kings, the queen, the emperors, and all the, of course, the actors and actors, the famous people, the stars that they used to throw around. And they are actually, we are talking about their drink, their favorite drink, what they likes and dislike in our, you know, in the favorite cocktails. And think of Ernest Hemingway. Think of daiquiri or mojito. Would it be today a classic cocktail without Ernest Hemingway talk about it? That would be still in Floridita and Botequita del Medio. In Cuba, you would not know today. It would not have been a classic without him talking about it, putting it, writing books, going to talk shows and like me and talk about it. So that's what we had. But now look at this. You know, we have now. Where is it? Shall I show off? There you are. Yeah, Facebook, tweet. You know, Instagram. All that for you. And I'm sure you're using it, but please do be, you know, involved. Be involved. be there. And if you, I don't know how many bartenders are here. I don't know how many bars. Yeah, I can see a little bit more. Maybe I can get used to the lights. Or maybe they took the light off there. But anyway, I can see that. Use it, guys. And all the cocktails that you make, put it on Facebook, on Instagram, because they are dated. They are dated. There will be a date in there. Nobody will go to take it away from you. They can use it because you can stop it, but it's yours in the future. Yeah? So use it. And the thing is, of course, the customer, they also have use of the media. So they can be very knowledgeable. They are now the customer quite knowledgeable because they've got the information on the press of the button. So you, bartenders, you had to do a bit of more works when it comes to know things. You had to work out, you had to be more knowledgeable, more with it. And there you are. Now you have more high quality ingredients. No more regional, because no seasonal, no ice is seasonal. How lucky are you, goodness? Think how much you have in your disposal. As I say, new, available, high premium. And there you are in the cocktail open. Now, of course, you have in London and all over the world, they have wonderful bars, great bartenders, great energy. I love them. I love it all dearly. And if I embrace them and I cuddle them, not because I feel very proud of the young people today, the young bartenders. I'm really excited about that. But now the bars are competing with the hotel bars very well indeed. In most cases, they surpass. They're even better than most of the bars in the hotels. So good for them, good. I like that very much. Et voilà. So let's get moving on. There you are. Look at the customers has changed. Yes, of course, they are much more knowledgeable, aren't they? We spoiled them. We have spoiled them all these years. So they now, they pay back time. Yes? So they are much, as I say, much more knowledgeable, and we are to be the same. They have much higher expectation because now, as I say, we spoiled them. Now they want more. They're not anymore satisfied with the basics. We have to give them more, you know? And this one here, how lucky you are, but in my time, we were fibbing. We are cheating. We were telling stories like God invented story. But we couldn't get the information anywhere. We couldn't get it. Even the books were not accurate. Even the books were a lot of nonsense, you know? But we made it up. We made it up with, make the customer happy. It's nothing to do, but now they can get it. So you're not cheat anymore. You cannot cheat anymore because otherwise they find you out. Because anything you do is going to be defined out by that. So be careful, guys. You know, you're going to be found out. Interesting to try new cocktails. Yeah, the cocktail experience. We are now beginning to have move in two different directions. I heard before of all the talk show that I had before. We talk about a lot of things like cocktails, like this. But no one had really come to that decision. The point that I'm making, that today people care about hospitality. Hospitality is now on, is in. You can't get away from this. The wheels have gone round. So there you are. You have everything in there. There you are, look at this. Have you got it right? On the plus side and on the plus side. There you are. And it's an amazing journey that bartender. Now the wheel has gone round, complete round. I don't know how many times the wheels go round in my life, but I can promise you that it's been round and round and round. And not just that, but think about fashion. About music, you know, everything is, you know, but it repeats itself. It goes round and round, and now we are now complete circle. From bartender to mixology to molecular. Oh, we must start a scientist now. I missed the molecular mixologist. We mustn't forget them. And now we are back to bartenders and with great hospitality skills. And the Dick Braxall, don't know anybody heard of Dick Braxall, bartender most probably you should know. The father of mixology, right? With him, we had an influx, or shall we say, an amazing amount of young people in our business with enthusiasm, passion, you know, energy. We had everything that the young people can bring into our business. Wonderful. And there are some of them. I put it there because I'm sure you recognize some of them. Yes, I don't know if you, some of them is amazing. Alice Crotena. Oh, yeah, you morning. Simone was here. Was it Simone Cabral? Was it did anything today? But anyway, that's it there. But they also now recognize the hospitality and the hospitality, the art of hospitality. They are now aware that hospitality and importance of hospitality is back. That's very, very important to them. Great ambassadors in our world, great ambassador. Right, how are we doing here? Have we got it right today on the negative side? Sorry, guys, you allow me. I'm not a grumble. I mean, I'm getting old, I know, but I try not to grumble too much. But I refer most of it to the London scene, our scene. But you know, we're still doing very well, London and the UK. But that whatever the youngsters do, there it ripples off to the rest of the world. Communication is very fast. So, I mean, it's mixology, great. I mean, I promise you, it's wonderful what they've done, the journey that we took. That we wouldn't be here today, I promise you. And the standard of our cocktails, the amazing cocktail we do, it won't be without that. The mixology or mixologist. But unfortunately, the negative side, if we got there, egos. I build up a few egos, especially up in London, I promise you. Big egos and egos that not belongs behind the bar, guys. Does not belong. You leave it at home. Or you share, which happens in London. There are a lot of bars, but bartenders' bars, where all the bartenders unite. You know, at night time, that you can see practically some bars is 95% bartenders. And yes, by all means, use the egos, because that's great. That stimulates each other. You stimulate, you are challenging each other. That's where creation comes in. That's great, honestly, that's wonderful. I'm not saying that it's bad, but in that case, it's good, but not generally speaking, not in your bar. When you go to your bar, that you leave it behind, really. please do. And the other thing that I have is that we lost a lot of trainers, the experienced bartenders, the experienced bartender through the company, stealing them, headhunting. So we lost a lot of our bartenders, become ambassadors, general manager, they do all sorts of things, and away from the bars, we lost them. So now the problem is that who is going to train the youngsters? Question, right? There are not many that are actually teaching us youngsters, make sure that the youngsters do it right. But of course the youngsters, they always, shortcut, imitating them without knowledge, as we said, work on there. It's imitating. So the shortcut for the search of fame, guys, dangerous. We are talking about alcohol here. Maybe it's not understood. But, now we have the cocktail safe. Cocktail safe blog, and whatever. But it's a blog, you can go there and search. And please do, because it teaches you, please, that there is a danger here. Artemisia 1. Is a dangerous thing to, that you're using. I mean, using tobacco. They're using tobacco. They're using all things like charcoal, activated charcoal. I don't know if you know. Do you know all these things like this? Charcoal. You know, if you don't know what to do with it, it's dangerous. It's poison. You're poisoning people. So please be careful with that. And if you have any doubt, go for the cocktail safe. Org. Please check that out, and so that you know that you're on the safe side of it. Yeah. And here, the other one, there are a lot of bars in London, and I'm sure they're developing all over the world, that they have something like almost 95% of signature cocktails. Cocktails that cannot be reproduced. So, you know, it's fine. It's fine that you have, you know, signature cocktail in your bar. By all means, I'm not saying no. But why that many, for goodness sake, you cannot reproduce? Even, I mean, if you do things like, you know, where's the customer there? Where is the customer? Where are your guest in there? If he likes your cocktail, he cannot make it. You know, I mean, it's pretty sad, I think. No, I don't know about what you feel, but this in my allow me that to say that, to be on that side of it is my personal view, my personal belief to all the things I've done in my life. So, right, here we go. What does it mean? We mean that we are going to lose all the progress that we made in the journey that we do. It's an amazing journey, but you want to lose it. And remember that now we are still on the second golden age of bartenders. We are on the second golden age. I don't know if you know, you're aware of it. I don't know, maybe you're not aware, but I can show you we are. But we're in danger to end it pretty fast if we are, you know, if you are not careful. I know we are changing with the time. You've got to change with the time. You've got to move on. So cocktails are much, you know, a classic cocktail and a twist of cocktails, much simpler to make, can easily be reproduced. And that's what customer like, what the customer demand, that's what we're finding now in London. This is a new energy here. And so that they much simpler, you know, much simpler thing. Because I know this is not very exciting for bartenders because they like to complicate things. You know, we are like, you know, 6 and 7 ingredients in all what we do, which is beautiful theater. It's a theater, it's wonderful to see. But be careful when it comes to actually your customer, you know, and the simpler drink is more, simpler taste. They know what they're drinking. Now the customer, as I say, they're knowledgeable now. They know what you're giving them, you know, and they want something much easier. And of course the cocktail can be reproduced. They want to, if you give them a cocktail and they like it, they would like to go and make it at home. Go home and make it at home with his friends and maybe a cocktail party. That is the new trend. But easier cocktails, easier to make, back to roots again, like the beginning I said to you, that we now you are gaining time. You're making time because they're easy to make. So you're gaining time. So you're getting that time invested in your customer. Yes? And how do we see the future? More knowledge, as I say, more knowledgeable customers. The value, the all experience, not only the cocktails, but the bartender, the personality comes in again now. Not just the cocktail, you know, and, you know, concentrate in the cocktail, in a little cocoon there. Do not disturb me, I'm creating. Wow. Yes, that's what happens sometimes. I heard it in London. Don't disturb me, I'm creating. And so, the personality comes in. The bartender, you as a person, your personality, your savoir-faire, your you know, everything, and professionalism there, hospitality, to greater hospitality skills, ability to create magic moment. I don't need water. But excuse me. I should have been prepared. There you are. So it's more you. Surprisingly enough, you, the cocktail, shall we say, the bar, of course, the ambiance, the place. So the place, you, and the cocktail. You see, one of the priority somehow a shift, and you will feel it because that's what's happening in London, and I'm sure that it rippled off. But I already noticed in Paris, definitely in Germany, in Spain, definitely in Spain. So it's rippling. It's happening. It's coming. So there you are. The other one is food pairing. The food pairing, of course, that means that in the future is wine-based cocktail. So be ahead, guys, be ahead. Embrace it, embrace it. What are we talking about here? We're talking about sherry. We're talking about wine, sherry, Madeira. We're talking about port, vermouth. We know vermouth. Low ABV, that's what people start asking. They don't want a strong anymore. They're not really very strong cocktails. They're beginning to want to ask for low ABV. And the other thing they're asking is that, the beneficial effect. And they like the fact that for example, lower calorie, you know, the diatetic cocktail. I don't know if you heard of the expression, but the diatetic means 100 calorie per drink. That is coming. And it's beginning to be more. They are more health conscious. You know, the binge drinking, or the drink drinking is moderating. So, but be ready. I mean, that is what is coming. So be ahead of the time. Yes? Right. So, what does hospitality involve? Let's see if I can try that again. Voilà. Ooh. Ooh. There should be a bit lower, but step for the senior citizens. Anyway, so there you are. What is hospitality involved? Very important to get things right. Let's see. Boom. There you are. Greeting of every guest in a warm and welcome way. The Savoy in the American bar is people used to come with very high expectation. I mean, think about it, you know, the people say, oh my God, they're in the American bar, Savoy, wow. If I had in mind to have a gin and tonic, also, no, I can't have a gin and tonic here. Obviously, we must have a cocktail, no? This is an immediate reaction of the customer. It would be that, right? So, the most important thing that we had in an American bar was the door, reception. People used to come, you know, where they used to come in. But this is applied to everything. It applies to your bar as well. The people come to your bar, it still applies. It's still people come to you, come towards you. And I taught my staff, very important, the body language. The body language is practically the most important thing that we have. But most people don't read it, don't follow it, don't understand it. But this is to us very important as a bartender. And so the door, for example, to us is very important because the immediate approach to the customer, the immediate reaction. So the greeting was important, again, not only for the customer point, but for us is to be gentle movement, move very slowly, especially tall people. Tall people, be careful, guys, because if you go too near the customer too quickly, the customer lean back because it's quite a threatening behavior. You know, it does, you know, something. So to move very slowly and relax and read the customer. If a customer, for example, I don't know, body language, I give you an idea. The city people, I'm talking about the city people, used to come very heavy footed and the shoulder like this. So it tells you. It tells you the guy had a pretty bad day, you know, pretty tough day, is it? You know, tired, right? So I said, hello, good evening, sir. Welcome to the American Bar. My God, it looks like a pretty tough day, hard day. You used to go like this, yeah? Yes? And what do you do next? What we used to do, and all my stuff was exactly the same, what we used to do, yes, of course. Please come in. Anybody joining you? I'll say, my wife, I'm waiting for my wife. We're going to the cinema or the set, or in many cases, whatever. So what would you do then? I mean, talking about the welcoming, all part of the welcoming factor. What would you do? Would you sit in the middle of the room? Would you put him near the piano where the noise is? I don't think so. I think that's a pretty... He would put him somewhere around, maybe in a corner. Well, it's quieter, it's more seduced, so that it actually can calm down. And the other thing we used to do, we used to go and I say, please sit down, I'll be in a moment, and I go and pick up a glass of champagne, I say, there you are, sir, have a glass of champagne on the house. What did I do? We relaxed the customer, of course, they gave him a chance to relax, number one, but then we took a decision, another decision. Think of this, guys. In the office, it's 7 o'clock in the morning, answering the phone calls all over the world because of the stockbrokers, all over the world, yes? Then he said, you know, the door opened, question, answering question, boom, comes at 5:30, came to me in the American bar, and what do most people do, or come to your bar, what are you going to do? What would you like to drink? Another decision. Why does he have to give him another decision making? Why? Give him the glass of champagne. To me, it was the cheapest drink I could give because it cost me nothing. Hardly cost me hardly anything, a glass of champagne. It was the cheapest thing, more expensive than gin and tonic. You know, the gin and tonic more expensive than the champagne. In your case, it would be most probably a little glass of Prosecco. It doesn't have to be champagne, you got Prosecco. Just introduce, sorry? Anki and Anki Panki, yes. I usually say that because there are a few ladies, and you know, when they do the demonstration, do something like this, and there are ladies involved. And a lot of ladies actually in our world complaining. There are quite a few complaining the fact that they enter in the man's world. Yeah? And I usually I love that one. You know, the man's world, they all, you know, to compete with a man, whatever. But then I said, let me tell you something about the man's world. This woman, Ida Coleman. Ida Coleman is the first bartender in the American Bar Savoy. Ladies were not allowed in the bar. Just a moment. Now, that's the man's world, is it? I mean, it's entering the man's world. There you are. That's the one. Because there were no ladies. It was the only woman in an entire room full of important people, like I mentioned to you, film star, president, prime ministers, everybody, which I told you, and woman in the bar. And what she did? Hanky Panky. I mean, that, amazing. Don't you give me the name, Hanky Panky? No? I mean, it's wonderful. And so there you are, you know? It says it's a cast one cast. What would you do, for example, a nice couple, nice romantic, holding hands, you know, talking nice and soft to each other. What would you do with it? Good evening, welcome to the American Bar. Would you put them behind near the piano with lots of noise? Would you put them in the middle? No, of course not, because they like to each other, want to talk to each other, all the lovey-dovey, they have to tell all this. So you put them somewhere where it's a little more private, shall we say, not so much in the middle, but also with a view of what's going on around. So they like to be able to talk to each other and whatever, and then also look at the bar. This, wouldn't you say that? But what about the three or four people? You know, laughing, a little bit louder than usual. Would you put it in a quiet corner? No. Would you put it near the piano? Yes, because it was probably the one who wants a bit more music, want to have a fan. You know? So, you know, this, all things like this, it's all part of the welcoming. I don't know if I can put something pretty quickly. Take care of the need. You are taking care of the need, do you? I mean, we already mentioned. Meeting surprise, obviously, once you do all that, when you actually meet all this, what I've been saying to you, make them comfortable, make them relax, welcome them. There you are. This will be the next stage, is it? There you are. To achieve this, bartender needs to perfect many skills. In addition to the knowledge of alcohol and cocktail, they includes altruistic, mindful approach to the well-being of the guest. Means be kind, be generous, kind-hearted, open your heart, for God's sake. You're talking about people's business. You are in the people's business. So please open up and be as comfortable as possible and be relaxed and take care of your customer. The ability to understand the relation between you and the bartender guest, that's another one we mentioned, the ability to communicate with and to understand your guest. I mean, especially in hotel bars, that's the most probably hotel bar more than ever, because the customer used to come into the room, they come to the hotel. What did he used to do? Goes to the room, and the next thing, the first thing after that, quickly to the bar. That's what people, you know, most single men or men do. And what did they come to the bar to do what? I mean, to chat, to talk to you as a bartender. You are the target. They want to have a little chat, you know, to be entertained. The trouble is sometimes that they monopolize you. The trouble is if you're busy, the guy keep on monopolize you. So you have to find a way to deal. What we used to do, what I used to do, and introduce to another guest. So, hello, John. David, look, I introduce John. John, can I introduce David? David is from the States. And let them talk to each other. So you move off. They leave you alone, shall we say, or they give you a bit of time. But also, upselling. Very important. You have to be a good salesman apart from everything else. And good to, you know, to make money. Here we go. Important lesson. A happy customer experience. The well-run bar you need. Bang. Here we go. To be motivated, passion about bartending. Understand that is a career, not a job. Most of my time used to be, youngster used to come to me and say, I'm looking for a job. Wonderful. Good for you. That's the door. They were taken back and surprised. I say, what did I say? Well, they said the wrong thing. If you're looking for a way of life, a career, this is a place. If you look at a job, that's the door, because there's no place for you here, because chasing money, guys, please don't do it. It's a very tough life, bartender is tough, you know, it's not easy, right? So anyway, think of somebody like me. Next year I'm 80 years old, right? So I worked my day life, and my working life would be between 10 to 14 hours. It would make 2 hours to get from job to home and back and forth. 2 hours. Let's say for the sake of arguments, 10 hours. 2 hours transport, 12 hours. How many hours you sleep? An average 7 hours, shall we say 7 hours approximately? Yeah? That's 19 hours. Leaves 5 hours for you, 5 hours a day. That means that I'm 80 years old, yeah? And I can say I've lived 16 years. What does it sound to you? Because if anybody tells me, or told me before I done it, that I would be only 16 years out of 80, I would blow my mind and thinking maybe the next reincarnation I will have a better deal. I mean, I don't know about you, but certainly to me it's horrendous to think of that way. But if your 10 hours is your life, and you approach everything what I'm saying to your life, it is not that bad, is it? It would be something like, almost 50, yeah, nearly 50 years out of 80. Not bad. Lend that to assess the customer need. We already mentioned, meeting it, and I will, caring and with no intrusion. Again, we're talking about the business people. They want a quick action. They want to drink fast, but they don't want to be bothered because they're talking about business. They don't want you to start annoying them. So, and the same thing with a couple, for example. They want to be by themselves. They like you to make a big effort, like suggesting cocktail, making cocktail, and do your spill, but they don't want to be in don't have to be intrusion. You don't want intrusion. So think about the things like this. It's very important. And all about lesson learned, to adapt in every situation. Wonderful. I'm a Gemini. I don't know about you. I don't know. Are there many Geminis here? Gemini? Only one? Really? We are that few? Come on, we're not bad. Come on, Geminis, guys. Well, you want to kill a Gemini? You want to destroy a Gemini? Repetition. Give him a repetition and you kill it. You kill a Gemini. Become like a zombie. No? And what a better for me. That's why I chose this job, because every day is different. Every moment, every time, every situation is different. So a Gemini is paradise. To me, it's ecstasy to live in the situation. Bad, good. And you need a good and bad in everything. Teamwork. Wow. That, if you want to be successful, teamwork. There is no other way. When I started the Savoy, there were 14 people. 14 wages. 14 wages, 14 people. When I took over, seven. Seven people do the same job, and they do the same job that they're doing today. Seven. Teamwork. We were a really amazing team that I had. Today, they're great team. Today, they are a really great team. I'm very proud of them. They're very good. And excellent cocktail, excellent service, nothing wrong whatsoever. What are they doing? Because they're wonderful. But 22 people, 22 wages, right? And we did it with seven. To create the same standard, the same situation, the same thing with seven people. That's teamwork. That's when everything works. Right? There you are. To be away is what's happening around you. You can avoid confrontation. You know, in our jobs, the lions become lambs and lambs become lions. the drinks for you. So you can only avoid, the trouble if you're constantly aware. In the American bar, when they have, as I speak, people who've been there, but there are a lot of blind spots. You say if you are at the bar, there's a lot of places you cannot see. So it's very difficult to manage it because you don't know what's going on around the corner. But I have the pianist we had the certain notes on the piano. Ta-ta-ta-ta, ta-ta-ta-ta, danger. Well, I hear the notes. What? The danger. What? Boom. There is me. Danger. Well, where is he? Where is he? So he was warning me. We were communicating. I was communicating with the pianist. And then they put the few notes, the high notes and low notes together. Ta 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 ta, like this. Yeah. Be here. Come here. You need it. All the things that we do, as I say, when it comes to communication to manage the bar, that's something that. And if you have something similar, work out some way that you can communicate and be avoiding danger situations. So you're ahead of it. Remember, there's always something to learn. 3 months ago, I had an interview with an Evening Standard, and the poor girl said to me, I said, Peter, you've done almost everything. What there is for you to do? What there is something for you? And I said, are you joking? The poor girl said, ooh. I said, he took it back a little bit. But I said, no. I said, well, sorry, Don, I didn't mean to start on you. But I feel like a beginner. I feel like after 56 years of bartender, I'm just starting now. You never stop learning, guys. Never stop learning. Don't give up. Keep going, all right? And yes. And a person who tells you he knows everything is the last person who does know. I promise you. Ignore him. Right. My definition of bartender, I've got to put this one here. I'm sorry, I had to do this. It's a performance art with the bartenders undertaking many different roles. Aren't we, eh? Who say that job is easy? I'll say, let's quickly do it. A friend. Now, unfortunately, in my time, I said to you, with the easy cocktail, easy to make, we had plenty of time to make a friend of a customer. Unfortunately, it's not the case for you. I think your maximum, the times you have, is about 20 minutes, maximum. Maybe half an hour if I'm generous, to make a friend of the customer so that you have a very good chance to come back again. That is, you got to have, you have to do that. Diplomat, yes. Well, no, we have to be very diplomatic there. You know, you hear, you see many things in our world, and the discretion is the other. Discretion and diplomacy is two things that we have to have. You have to be very discreet, right? Because we see things, right? A therapist, yeah, my goodness, yes. After a few drinks, you know, our shoulder. I don't know about you. You know, I don't see you bartenders, but you have a nice big shoulder. Because there are a lot of people, after a few drinks, they come and tell all the sad stories, everything that happens to them. And you need to be a good therapist. A peacemaker, yes, of course, I'll tell you, lime, you know, a few drinks, bang, you know, you have problems with that. So you have to calm down, guys, calm down. Peacemaker, and all things is possible. That means that it's never ending. Every situation is different. Nothing is written in stone. Everything changes at the split second. So be aware. I'm doing with time. I'm okay, I'm not overdoing it. Paul, carry on. Are you bored? Can I carry on or shall I stop it? No, okay, look, yes, okay. Observation, you know, I can go on and on, and you know, this there, expectation has been surprised. It's to know the customer, communicate the customer. It's all part of the amazing world we live in, the bar world, where we love to not only making drinks, but to communicate, finding things out, you know, surpass, you know, again, to the Savoy American Bar, to actually go and meet the expectation. It's not good enough. It's not good enough. We just say, oh, yes, I've been to the American Bar. Yeah, it wasn't bad. It wasn't bad. But you surpass the expectation. You go the extra mile, create a magic moment. There they remember. They say, my God, I've been to the American Bar. We're amazing. The bartenders were amazing. The cocktails were fantastic. And so that's what that means, that they will obviously will be back. Eh? And obviously content to come again. Oh, yeah, sorry. What is it? This is the one that, to me, I put it there. But Gary Regan. Anybody go right? Gary Regan? Gary Regan, amazing American guy. And I had to put this is, he said, I have learned that people will forget what you say, people will forget what you did, but will never forgive you and forget what you make them feel. That is a big, big one. That's what it's all about. Yeah? Because now it's not customers, it becomes much more knowledgeable. So they need more than a cocktail. There is an emotive feeling. It's all about magic moment, feeling, lead the moment, you know, the experience, the entire experience. It's not anymore the cocktail. The cocktail is just part of the entire thing, the entire experience. There you are. Understand your customer. Communications, very important. They get the signals, you know, watch for the signals. I say body language. In most cases, you can see the customer is relaxed. You can see they're sitting down, very comfortable, having a drink, and nice to relax, very nice. But sometimes you don't have the time to read the body language. So ask, hello, how are you? Are you enjoying the cocktail? You know, you can see you're enjoying the cocktail. If it's half empty or maybe empty, you say, would you like another one? I'm selling, you know, selling. Again, they will appreciate that if they want another one. You're taking care of them. And find out whether a special occasion. As I said before, we did Savoy, American, the American Bar was famous, you know, for creating cocktail for special occasion. Find out, you know, why you are with you. Are you, it's a special occasion, and birthday, very, in American Bar was famous for birthdays, anniversaries, wedding anniversary, coming to age. This is all things that they come to Savoy and always ready for cocktails. Oh, wow, yes. Can we make it a cocktail? Can you do that? Can you make it a cocktail? Yes, of course, for the occasion. Again, it's part of that magic the magic that can all create. And find out, of course, that that's, you know, obviously, if you do, what would you like? How would you like? Would you like gin, vodka? What flavor would you like? You know, find out with a test. To give them just a cocktail without knowing this, knowing what they like, the aroma, the taste, you know, if you like gin, you give them rum. I mean, it would be absurd, wouldn't it? I mean, it would be, so find out what they like, and very important to know their likes and dislikes. And there you are. I think most probably I'll leave you with this. I'll leave you with this because I most probably come to an end. And I don't know how long, but are we okay? No? I mean, okay, look, I'll leave you with it, the necessary mindset. There you are, look. I'll have a bit of fun with you. Look, here you are. Positivity. Motivation. Be motivated because, I mean, it's a tough job. You have to be motivated. Find a way to motivate yourself. Find a way to deal, you know, to cope with the day humdrum. It's a pretty bad, pretty tough job. The discretion, we already mentioned, right? You are. Attentiveness, be attentive. I already mentioned that. Willing to put the customer before you. Leave your problem behind, whether you arrive with your wife or whatever, or whatever it's happened. Leave it at home. Leave it at home, really. And, you know, and it's therapeutical as well, you know, to leave your worry behind a little bit for how many hours, whatever. It's nice. You know, it's not a bad thing to do. And find somebody that interests you. Find a customer that you like. So you talk to him, and then maybe you have a nice, better time. Worry behind, as I say, concern, leave it at home. Enjoy what you're doing, of course. Otherwise, what's the point? Find something else. Find something else to do. My God, it's a tough job. There's no point to do it. This day and age, do something you don't want to do or don't like to do it. Stay in the moment. That's and there you are. The importance is part of the customer experience is not the drink, but the hospitality. And voila. Look, I'm very, you know, I did all that. And smile. Keep smiling, baby. Keep smiling. Can I leave you one thing? I know I shouldn't do that. But I can leave you something. It's personal, of course. Please don't take me, seriously, Eddie. Well, but it's called part of the age, 79, and you know, dealing with people. It's all about psychic, you know, pick up all this, whatever. Apart from leaving all the worry behind, let me tell you something which is, you know, it's maybe I shouldn't do, but I do. And then you can blame me on it, okay? Yes and no in your life does not exist. It's an illusion. Try to remember that how come you say it? Think of an electrician. Think of someone who does the job like plumber, electrician, whatever. They need the tools. Don't they need tools? They need a screwdriver. They need a plumber. They need all the tools. But what happens when he finishes the job? What happens when he finishes the job? What he does with the tools? What he does? He puts it away, didn't he? Didn't he put it away? And that's what you're supposed to do. Please do when you come to yes and no. Yes and no is the tools. So once you finish your job, because you need to communicate, you've done all this wonderful thing, when you've done that, don't use it. Replace it with maybe, perhaps, could be, possibly. I don't know if this translation is right for you, but that's what you replace it with. So if you hear me talking and telling you that, I may be right or possibly right. Don't say yes or no, because you're yes or no, you're closing the door. Okay? So that is my gift to you, or shall we say what I can give it to you as a human being at 80 years old. God bless you, take care, and have a good life. I'm too long.
I have been drinking with this man for far too many years that I know. But if someone ever asked me what I want to be like when I'm 70 or 80, I want to be like Peter Durelli. He is the man, the legend. So can I hear it for the last speaker on Friday for Barometer 2019? Let's hear it for Peter Durelli. All right, people, as you know, the bars downstairs are open till 10 o'clock tonight. There's lots of activity happening, lots of guest shifts happening in bars around the city. But we'll see you tomorrow. First lecture tomorrow is at 12 o'clock here at the main stage. So see you soon.